the prior parts of this scripture lesson. All of this we hear today in the Bible. And it's a pretty strange pericope, a pretty strange group of readings for this Sunday. A couple of weeks ago, I was listening to the radio, and I was hearing something which I thought was pretty strange, which I had not heard before. It was something called National Pi Approximation Day. Have you ever heard of this? Kelly, our math teacher, has heard of this. Now, for the rest of you, or the rest of us, let me tell you, pi, I've got a logic lesson. This is pi. Approximation of pi, I guess. It is defined as a mathematical constant, which is more or less 3.14159, etc., etc., etc. How many of y'all remember that from geometry class way back when? Good for you. It's further defined as the ratio of a circle's circumference to the dynamic, to its diameter in Euclid geometry. And it's also an irrational number. I have no idea what that means.
It's infinite and non-repeating.
Perfectly illustrated. I don't know. You can read the definition. I can read you the definition. I can tell you what the words mean. But I really don't know what pi is. I really don't have an experience of pi. Now, I'm sure back in my mathematics days, when I was in high school, I had a little bit firmer grasp on the concept that is pi. Pi was something that I must have been able to use, because I certainly passed algebra and geometry and where did I introduce pi, other than home economics? Trigonometry. Ooh. Bad idea to bring that up. So I had that concept mastered. But that mastery is gone. Pi is now a disembodied Greek letter representing a strange mathematical idea. And today we're confronted by two of the stranger passages in Scripture. One, our first reading, is from Numbers. It's obscure and it's strange. The other, from the Gospel of John, is strange and strangely familiar. The Hebrews are journeying around the land of Edom by way of the Red Sea, and of course, as anybody would on a 40-year trip, they get a little impatient. They're questioning the wisdom of their sudden departure from Egypt, complaining that there is no food, no water, and if you've ever been in that part of the Middle East, no shame. I can imagine that I too would get a little irritated, short-tempered, maybe a little impatient. What would be the logical thing to do? No food, no water, constant traveling, no place to lay your head. What would be the next logical step if you had the ultimate power? Poisonous snakes. I would prescribe poisonous snakes. That seems to make perfectly good sense to me. Doesn't it you? That'll take their minds off their problems, right? So God tells Moses to fashion a serpent of bronze, put it on hold, and when one of the people are bitten, they should gaze upon it, and then live. A serpent of bronze. Seems perfectly straightforward to me. Lift up a bronzen image of a creature that is biting and poisoning you and live. Strange stuff the Bible has for us sometimes. Confusing stuff. Stuff you can't really grasp. People all around the world fear snakes. Very common fear in all societies of the world, at least all societies I've ever heard. And my father was no Indeed, my whole family is no different. However, my brother and I were slightly different. One day, my brother Keith and I were playing with a garter snake, a little green snake. I don't know where we found it. We were fascinated. We weren't afraid of it. We were just playing with it. But as little boys do, we lost track. Lost interest, I guess is more than the point. And my brother put the snake in his pocket, in the front pocket of his jeans. Nice and warm, I guess the snake figured it had enough, it's going to sleep, leave me alone. And we totally forgot about it. Totally forgot about it. That is, up until my mom was doing a load of laundry. She screamed. My father came racing down the stairs to find out what all the screaming was about. When he found what all the screaming was about, he screamed. Well, I was sure, I was absolutely positive that we were going to get it, but good. Anything that would cause all this screaming could not be good news for Keith or I. So I don't know what it was, but I just reached around my mom, reached around my father, I grabbed that little snake, picked it up, walked it outside, and let it go. Then I had the longest walk I ever had in my life, coming back to the house, bracing myself to meet my maker and my dad. But the strangest thing is that my father was so relieved. He totally forgot about punishing us. He totally forgot about where the snake had come from. All he knew is that that little reptile had been snatched up, taken out, and was no longer a threat to him or his family. The green snake. Go figure. As obscure as Moses' lifting up of the bronze snake to save the Hebrews, so the passage from John is familiar. It's probably one of the most familiar pieces of scripture in the entire Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. We used to see the chapter and verse every time that there was a major American sporting event. Do you remember the guy with the rainbow hair and the big fuzzy? And he'd hold up the sign. John 3:16. Y'all hold that up all the time. I don't know where, there must have been more than one of these events. Because they were every single major sporting event that was being broadcast for years. I don't see him anymore. I don't know what ever happened to him. But you don't see John 3:16 like you used to. And it's so strange because there was nothing so iconic as that man holding up John 3:16. That was what America was from, I'm sure, from the mid-70s until the mid-80s. And he was always within camera shot. That's why I always thought, there has to be more than one of these guys. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. For so many people, this is a truly moving statement that points out the profound love that God has for. A love so extraordinary that God would be willing to sacrifice a child. And there have been times when I may have felt that way too. It's not hard to be reminded of the story of Abraham and Isaac, in which Abraham was willing to sacrifice his only son because God had told him to. But more and more, I'm beginning to see how unimaginably painful it would be to lose a child. And I began to see how truly unthinkable it would be to willingly sacrifice not just my child, if I have one, but anybody's child. For some, the idea that God would and did give up Jesus to die is an unfathomable and frightening expression of God's feeling towards that child. I can't help but ask why, what kind of parent would in any instance consciously choose to sacrifice his or her child? And while this is intended as an expression of love for us, God's children, what kind of parent is this? Is the God who would do this worthy of our devotion? We now find ourselves in a truly unreal set of circumstances. How can we love and worship a God whose actions so confound us? God is a parent willing to allow one of his children to be killed, granted, for the sake of the rest of his children. How can we love someone who so profoundly acts and whose acts elicit such repulsion, fear, devotion, even attraction? I mean, could we worship and love a God like that? Should we worship and love a God like that? Classically, this concept, the concept of Christ's sacrifice for us, they have called this the atonement. That is, that the death of Christ has become a means of our salvation. John's Gospel sees salvation as accomplished through the saving death of Jesus, and it is Christ who is the source of our salvation. The death of Jesus is the source of our salvation. The goal of Jesus coming into the world is salvation, which is accomplished by being lifted up on the cross. Whole denominations have been formed over us, over these kind of questions. And God help us, wars have been fought over issues of doctrine like this. The parallel between Jesus being lifted up to the cross and Moses lifting up the serpent, the bronze on a pole, is explicit. But I have to confess that I'm feeling about the atonement and Moses' serpent of bronze much like I feel about pie. I know what the definitions are. I know what the words mean. I may at one time or another have even mastered the concept, but I don't feel like I truly know it at all times. So it's kind of like that for me. It's kind of like pie. I think I've known it in the past. I know that there are people who know it. And they truly know it. But it's not what I can grasp or put my arms around. In the end, it's not so much what we know or the concepts that we master. For me, at least now, in this moment, what it's about is how we treat each other. Concepts form great ideas for us, but they don't meet the needs of the people. Common thread in Moses' serpent of bronze and John's idea of Christ's atoning death is that they are both lifted up. Maybe what we're being told by Moses' serpent and John's idea of the atonement is that we should not focus exclusively on what is right in front of us. Maybe we should lift our gaze up, lift it up from the narrow path that we are focusing on. And maybe we should start taking in a broader picture. The important thing is that we help each other lift up, to look up. Whether we're on a 40-day journey or a 40-year journey, we should try to help each other negotiate the path over which we travel. We need more than two eyes to help us step over the stumbling blocks in our path. And in the end, whatever path that we travel, whatever path we choose, and those paths may be different for each one of us, I do believe that the journey is the same. The important thing is to honor the journey of each individual and to help them along in that spiritual path. same if we lifted up our gaze from our own narrow self-interest and included a broader horizon for ourselves and our families and our friends and indeed the whole world. Amen. Our hymn of invitation is number 332. As we gather to